The power of sound doctrine. The power of sound doctrine. Every human being you see on the surface of the earth is driven by something. Every human being you see on earth is controlled by something. There is always a story behind every human being. And therefore, for the Church of Christ, we need to understand what is the story behind us. And today I'd like to talk about the power of sound doctrine. I'm reading from the book of Titus, chapter 2, verse 1. It says, "But as for you, teach the things which are in agreement with sound doctrine, which produces men and women of good character, whose lifestyle identifies them as true Christians." If you want to know the quality of something, look at the product that thing is producing. If you want to know the potency of something, look at the product. If you have a medication and you want to know how potent that medication is, take that medication and see if you get better from where you are. And when you see the result of that medication, it tells you the potency of that. Now, scripture is talking to us about the power of sound doctrine. What is sound doctrine? Doctrine simply means teachings. Doctrine simply means teachings. So as a child of God, the Bible says, "As for you, teach." Another word for teaching in scripture is instruction. Therefore, a child of God must and should be constantly exposed to instruction. The Bible says, "Know ye not that you have been bought with a price, and the life you now live is no longer yours." And because of that fact that you are no longer yours, you must walk based on instruction. You lost your own will to choose when you gave it to the Lord Jesus Christ. I want us to know that when we got born again, our identity was changed. The old is gone, the new has come. And because the new has come, the old is supposed to completely vanish. And right standing is what we receive at salvation. We stand right before God. We are righteous before God when the Lord called us into Christ Jesus through faith in him. But the word of God, which is the source of instruction, is what causes us to have what we call right walking with God. We must walk in conformity with our identity. Every child of God must know that it is required of us to walk in accordance to our identity. And therefore, instruction is part and parcel of who we are. And so this scripture says teach. So teaching is very essential. Every man lives and acts according to his thoughts and what he believes. Every man lives and acts and behaves according to what he believes. If you see somebody behave in a certain way, it's because of his belief structure. And because of that, it's very important what you believe. Hallelujah. So, what a man believes is a direct result of his thoughts. How the man lives is a direct result of his thoughts. This means that teaching has a direct impact on action. Teaching has a direct impact on action. In fact, action is a product of teaching. Action is a product of what you believe. And what you believe is a product of what you have been taught. This is the reason why, if you see a young boy performing excellently in school, you see a young boy performing excellently in sports, everybody begins to ask, whose son is that one? Everybody to ask, whose daughter is that one? They want to know who is your father because they want to know what influenced you to be so excellent. When a child is doing well, everybody asks of his parents. Why? Because you are a product of the teaching that you have received. And that is why at the same time, when a child or somebody behaves badly, the first question people ask is, who is that guy's father? Why? Because the product, you are a product of the teaching that you have received. And therefore, there is power in teaching. So the scripture says, teach. Teaching is a vital tool. It is a vital tool, and teaching must be aimed at effective change, even in behavior. The power of the Holy Spirit must be behind every teaching. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is the inspirer of the word. The Holy Spirit is the author of the word. Therefore, the source of instruction is the Holy Spirit. The medium of instruction is the word of God. And the vessel of instruction is the man that God uses. I repeat that. The source of instruction is the Holy Spirit. The medium of instruction is the word of God. And then the vessel through which the instruction is dished out, most at times, is the human vessel. Therefore, the church has been a product of instruction. The Bible tells me in the book of Acts, in the book of Acts chapter 2 verse 42, it says, they were continually and faithfully devoting themselves to the instruction of the apostles and the fellowship and to eating meals together and prayers. The church, the early church, met every day, and the Bible says they continued continually and faithfully in instruction. Instruction is another word for teaching. Therefore, the food of the believer is instruction. And that is why most of the scriptures, most especially if you go to the epistles, you will find out that it is instructional in nature. One of the evidence of the residence of the Holy Spirit in the life of a man is his openness to instruction from the Word of God. One of the evidence of the fact that the Holy Spirit is resident in the life of a man is how he's seen and how he responds to instruction that comes from the Word of God. Therefore, this morning, I'd like to challenge you wherever you are. The question is, how do you respond to instruction of the Word of God? It says, teach the people of God. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. And therefore, the church gathered every day for instruction. When you see a man that resists instruction, know that the spirit contrary to the Holy Spirit is motivating him. Anywhere you see a man who is kicking against the instruction from the Word of God, know that that man is not led by the Spirit of God. Because the Spirit is the author, and the Bible says those who are led by him are the sons of God. Therefore, every child of God must respond. The question is this: how come I've been a child of God for 10 years and I'm still giving excuses for living the life? How come I have been a child of God for 5 years and every day people will talk to me, I will say, no, just leave me. I am work in progress. Oh, leave me. This is my character. God loves me the way I am. Oh, leave me alone, because salvation is by faith. Listen to me. Faith takes you to right standing. Instruction guides you in right walking. And we are required to walk right. How is your life with God? How is your fellowship with God? Who enhances your fellowship? What are the influences in your life? What are the voices that are speaking into your life? What are the factors controlling and regulating your behavior and conduct? A lot of people talk about the fact that conduct doesn't matter. I am here to tell you the Bible says conduct matters, because conduct is the evidence of transformation. Conduct is the evidence of the residence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Conduct cannot be changed by human effort. Conduct cannot be changed by inhuman struggle. It is a product of the Holy Spirit in you. When the Holy Spirit comes into a man, he changes your taste. He changes your desire. Your ambition changes. The way you look at life changes. And therefore, your life begins to change. So if you receive Jesus and you are still living the way you lived before you received Jesus, then something is wrong somewhere, because the circuit is broken somewhere. The evidence of Jesus in your life is seen in the manifestation through your conduct. Glory to Jesus. Now the Bible says, instruct in accordance to sound doctrine. What is sound doctrine? Sound doctrine, to be sound means to be wholesome. To be sound means to be healthy. We are instructed as physical people to keep ourselves going, to live a balanced diet, a healthy, to stay healthy. It's the same thing with the Word of God. We must expose ourselves to sound doctrine. And the reason why Titus was instructed by Timothy, by Apostle Paul, to teach sound doctrine is because the teaching you give produces the people. So sound doctrine produces sound Christians. Good teaching produces sound instruction produces sound believers. And when you produce sound believers, the world can be changed. The coming of Jesus is around the corner, but the church is yet to finish the work. I challenge every child of God today. If you come to church, you see children of God everywhere. If you go to the offices, you look for children of God, you can't find them. If you go out in the marketplace, you look for Christians, you can't find them. Why? Because we are blended with the world. We speak the same language. We act the same way. We behave the same way. And yet, we are supposed to be children of God. And so if our confession does not match our lifestyle, then something is wrong somewhere. So the Bible says, teach sound doctrine. Hallelujah. Now, let's look at this instruction. And I want to read again in the book of Acts, chapter 11, verse 25 to 26. And in this scripture, that is the place where Christians began to be called Christians. After Stephen was killed, they stoned him to death. A wave of persecution came over the church, and the church could not stay in Jerusalem because the persecution was too much, and they began to scatter abroad. The Bible says some of these believers began to preach to the Greeks, they began to preach to the heathen, and it happened that in Antioch there were a lot of people that received the gospel. The Bible tells us, according to Acts chapter 11, I'll read verse 25 to 26, the Bible says, and Barnabas left for Tarsus to search for Saul. And when he found him, he brought him back to Antioch. For an entire 1 year, they met with others in the church and instructed large numbers. And it was in Antioch that the disciples were first called Christians. Barnabas, after he saw that the people of Antioch received the gospel, the Bible says he went in search of Saul at his own hometown called Tarsus. And when he found him, he brought him back to Antioch. And the Bible says they took 1 year instructing the body of Christ. And the Bible says there were multitudes of people that they were instructing, meaning they were teaching these people. And after 1 year, all these people began to look like little Jesuses all over Antioch. They began to speak like Jesus. They began to talk like Jesus. They began to look like Jesus. They began to behave like Jesus. And the Bible says it was there that the people of the world began to call them Christians, meaning little Jesuses. This is the power of sound teaching. This is the power of sound instruction. What voices are you listening to? What instructions are you receiving? And what is that instruction doing in your life? What is the word of God saying to you? And what will you do with the word of God? Salvation is not for decoration. Salvation is for transformation. Salvation is not for decoration. Salvation is not for us to brag that I am born again. Salvation is even not for us to be able to come to church and dance. Salvation is for transformation. So what voices are you listening to? And what are those voices producing in you? What kind of character is produced in your life? The Bible says it took them only 1 year and the church was begun to call Christians. How many years will it take you for somebody to look at your life and say, you are like Jesus? How many years must it take me for somebody to look at me and say, this guy, he's just like Jesus? How long does it take for transformation to take place in our lives? When you see men that resist instruction, you know that those are fools. The Bible says, a fool resists instructions. It is a foolish man that does not listen to counsel. And therefore, one of the predispositions of every believer is to be set to receive counsel from the Lord. Counsel that comes from the Holy Spirit doesn't leave you the same. Counsel that comes from the Holy Spirit changes something in you. And therefore, God is saying to us today that we must teach sound doctrine. We must not put sound doctrine to the background. We must not replace sound teaching with sound dancing. We must not replace sound teaching with dressing. We must not replace sound teaching with even acts of giving, because that is the product that comes foremost. The transformation must be seen in our lives. Hallelujah. So sound doctrine must produce sound Christians. In the end, we look like Jesus. At the end, we talk like Jesus. At the end, we are responsive to Jesus. The question is, what will you do today? Will you respond to the voice of the Holy Spirit through the scriptures? Will you respond? Will you become Jesus as a result of sound doctrine. The Bible says Jesus, to be like Jesus. How was Jesus? Number one, Jesus was faithful to the mission of the Father. Jesus was faithful to his Father. He never wavered. He followed the instruction of his Father. Throughout his life here, he set an example. Number two, Jesus was prayerful. He was full of prayer. Every day, Jesus would take time and find a solitary place to pray. Are you looking like Jesus? Do you pray every day to become like Jesus? Jesus was humble and obedient. The Bible says he was obedient even to the death on the cross. That is the kind of obedience Jesus had. Hallelujah. Jesus was forgiving. Even when he was hanging on the cross, as the people were killing Jesus, the Bible says, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. How many Christians are praying fire prayers on who they call enemies today? How many Christians will retaliate whenever something happens to us? Jesus said, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. To be like Jesus is to be forgiving. To be like Jesus is to be kind. To be like Jesus is to be compassionate, to have compassion. To be like Jesus is to hate evil. To be like Jesus is to be loving. This day, I challenge everyone listening to me. Will you let the Holy Spirit do a work in your life? Will you let the Holy Spirit begin to work a transforming life in you? Will you allow yourself to begin to walk according to your identity? Once you are in Christ Jesus, you are a new creation. New creation. Standing right before God. Will you want to walk right with God? I'd like to pray with you as I close. Everyone watching me, it doesn't matter whether you are in your home or where you are driving in a car and watching this podcast. And it doesn't matter where you are, whether you are in the hospital. I want you to lift up your hand as I pray with you. If you desire to see the result of the Holy Spirit working in your life, I want to pray for you this morning. And I know the power of God will reach you wherever you are. The hand of God will touch you wherever you are. You want to say, I am tired of not representing who I am. I am tired of living like the prodigal son when indeed I am in the house of the Father. I am tired of living a lie. I am tired of hypocrisy. I am tired of not representing Christ correctly. I want a change. If you are in that category, lift up your hand wherever you are. We will pray together for the mercy of God to come upon you, for the hand of God to touch you. Father, Lord, I thank you for everyone lifting up their hands, whether they are in their homes or whether they are in the church or whether they are wherever they are, in the car. Anywhere you are listening from, Father, I pray for these ones. As they lift up their hands, Holy Spirit, take charge of these lives. Holy Spirit, do a work in these lives. Holy Spirit, begin a work of transformation, that the light of Christ shall shine forth. Every source of evil is destroyed in our lives. The Bible says, for this purpose the Son of Man came, that he might destroy every work of the enemy. Everything that has held you bound, everything that has held you captive, today we address it in the name of the Lord. For when light comes, darkness runs out. Let light come into your life, breaking every chain of bondage, breaking every work of darkness, and destroying and bringing light into your life. May transformation take place all over the world. Let a revival begin in your life, that you begin to live like you are called to be. You begin to represent Jesus in your life. Thank you, Father Lord, for doing this, for we pray in the name of Jesus. In case you are not born again, you want to receive Jesus, and this word has touched your heart, pray this prayer with me. Say, Father Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner, and I know that I cannot save myself. I believe you came for me. I believe you died for me. I believe you rose again to give me life. And therefore, I renounce my sin and I come to you. I receive you, Jesus. From today, be my Savior. From today, be my Master. I will walk with you until I die. Thank you, Jesus, for forgiving me my sin. Thank you for transforming my life. Thank you for writing my name in the book of life. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name I pray. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a glorious day. I trust the Lord will continue the work in our lives. Thank you, Reverend Fernando.